We have two more speakers for this afternoon, and we're going to start with Lieutenant Colonel Thorsten Pippich of the German Air Force Institute for Aviation Medicine. He's an orthopedic specialist, flight surgeon, chiropractor. He specialized in sports medicine, and he completed MEMO in 2001. I was impressed. He's the head of orthopedics and anthropometry sports science department of the Division of Clinical Aviation Medicine at the earlier mentioned German Air Force Institute of Aviation Medicine at Fürstenfeldbruck. He's going to be talking about individualized training of trunk muscles. And of course, we have a question for you. So everybody, get your clicker. And can I please get Dr. Pippich's question? The question is, pilots do not need instructions or advice on physical fitness. Please answer that question with one, if you think that's true, and two, if you think that's false. And we'll cut it off when we have 100 responses. Is it open? Can you open the question for response? And I think there it is. Try again. No. We're trying it again. Yes, there we go. Almost halfway through. I am very curious. Some people are really thinking hard now. We're closing in on 80. Are we missing a lot of people? Because then 84. Come on, last ones. Okay, I think we can cut it off now. No more answers. Let's see what you think. Ooh. Well, let's see what Dr. Pippich has to say and if it changes your mind.
General, dear colleagues, next slide, please. My presentation is structured as follows. Introduction, strain of the jet pilot from an orthopedic point of view. I will present our statistical data about spinal injuries caused by using the ejection seat and data about the number of degeneration of the spine of pilots. I will explain our orthopedic aromatic examination proceedings, anthropometry, bioimpedance, video raster stereography, MRI examination of the whole spine, orthopedic specialist examination and evaluation. I will talk a little bit diagnostics of muscular performance and strength training, and we finish with a summary. Next, please. Despite the technological progress of the physical performance of the individual soldier in the modern operational army, still is one of the most significant preconditions for being successful in theater. The resilience of the individual soldier is of growing importance due to the high physical and psychological strain. A highly complex equipped, for example, and employment under extreme weather conditions call for highly capable personnel so that the alertness and operational readiness do not decrease due to premature fatigue. Next, please. What does a soldier need for accomplish with his or her military mission? The keywords are capabilities and skills. Capability is the ability to perform actions. It is applies to human capital. Capabilities is the sum of expertise and capacity. A skill is the learned capacity to carry out a predetermined results, often with a minimum outlay of time, energy, or both. Skills can be divided into domain general and domain specific skills. Some general skills would include time management, teamwork, self-motivation, leadership, and other. Domain skills would be useful only for a certain job. To sum it all up, capability is what do you have. You just need to realize them. Skills is what you acquire. The need to be developed and trained. Next, please. This applies particularly to Bundeswehr flight personnel due to the employment of modern and high-performance weapon systems, for example, Eurofighter, Tiger Combat Helicopter, NH-90 Medium Transport Helicopter and A-400M Transport Aircraft. The limiting factor for accomplishing the military mission is not an aircraft anymore, but is the pilot or the crew member. Next, please. In high-performance sports, as well in field of medicine, there are several legal and illegal methods to enhance human performance and sustainment. I will not name these methods in detail, but I want to show you one legal example. Next, please. Defense contractor Lockheed Martin developed an exoskeleton which is supposed to provide soldiers with superhuman powers. The device is called HULK, which stands for Human Universal Load Carrier. It does not seem to coincidence that the name sounds very similar to HULK, the green comic hero. Next, please. This technology is also used in medicine for people with a walking disability or paraplegia, for example, can walk again with an exoskeleton. In this presentation, I want to show you how an orthopedist can help you with the evaluation and improvement of pilots' physical performance, resistance, and sustainment. Next, please. I do not have to explain to you what strain there is on a jet pilot in a high-performance fighter aircraft. I just want to present two studies results which are important for an orthopedist and flight surgeon and which will reflect the strain on a jet pilot. Next, please. These are the consequences of rescue escape on the one side and the frequency and the severity of degenerative change of the spine on the other. In 2010, I analyzed 101 pilots and weapon system officers who had successfully ejected themselves from Phantom, Tornado and MiG-29 aircraft since 1974. In this context, successfully means that the ejection seat rescue system has been evacuated by the pilot or by ASA. Let us have a look at the last and bottom line only. 90% survived the ejection, 10% were killed, 48% those who survived did not have an injured spine, 52% were injured at the spine, 33% suffered from a spinal fracture, 20% suffered from an injury to the soft tissue on the spine. Injuries of extremities have not been taken into account in this study. Next, please. Since 2004, we conduct MRI examination of the complete spine in pilots who want to or have to change over to modern Bundeswehr aircraft. Until December 2011, we have examined 273 pilots, 107 Eurofighter, 115 Tiger, and 51 NH-90 pilots, and evaluated the findings. The frequency and intensity of complaints and symptoms are not taken into consideration in this evaluation. Please take a look at the following table. Let us look at the cervical spine only, columns 2 to 4. None means no degenerative changes in the MRI picture. Mild means mild changes in the MRI picture, such as chondrosis, protrusion, and spondylofit smaller than 2 millimeter. Significant means significant change in the MRI picture, such as osteochondrosis, extrusion, sequester, and spondylofit bigger than 2 millimeter, and spinal canal stenosis. In conclusion, I could determine that 35% of all pilots showed significant and 33% showed mild degenerative change of the cervical spine on the MRI picture. Next, please. In 1999, the RTO Technical Report 4, Cervical Spinal Injuries from Repeated Exposure to Sustained Acceleration, was published. In chapter 15, you can find the following statement. The selection process of pilots should include some form of spinal diagnostic imaging check for spinal abnormities. Clinical examination without spinal radiography were not an adequate screening method. Next, please. What does the orthopedist do when evaluating the military's pilot resilience and performance? When selecting applicants for assignment as a Bundeswehr pilot for all services, Air Force, Army and Navy, we use a special examination procedure. The procedure comprises three core areas: anthropometry, orthopedics and imaging, and sports science and performance diagnostics. Next, please. The orthopedic aeromedical examination starts with an anthropometric measurement. Currently, 19 body measurements are taken from all candidates, applicants, and all active pilots via measuring instruments, a measuring chair, and for all jet pilots via a 3D full body laser scanner. The measurement data are entered into a database and checked against the anthropometric limitations defined for a certain aircraft. That means 53% of all applicants fulfilled the requirements, 47% have to leave with certain restrictions. Next, please. Since 2010, every anthropometric measurement has been combined by the determination of the body composition using the bioimpedance method with InBody 720. What is being measured? See the protocol as an example. Body composition analysis, muscle fat analysis, obesity diagnosis, lean balance, visceral fat area, weight control and fitness score. Next, please. Our candidates and applicants for military flying duty are not adipose. For example, the body mass index BMI of these young men is between 23 and 24. To save time, I'm not going to discuss the method in detail. That only thing I'm going to say is that the results are considered when determining evaluating the muscular performance of the trunk and neck muscles. Next, please. In the examination phase, we also conducted a determination of the shape and position of the spine using video raster stereography, which is simple, non-invasive, radiation-free, and valid methods. Again, I cannot discuss the method and the results in detail for time reasons. Next, please. Since 2000, we conduct an MRI examination of the complete spine. For technical reasons, we divide the spine into the cervical spine and thoracic lumbar spine. The MRI screening comprises six sagittal section planes in the T2 weighted sequence of the cervical spine and the thoracic lumbar spine, and axial section images in the lumbosacral transition, as well as coronal section images of the lumbar vertebral arches. In case of abnormality findings, additional sequences are conducted, that is, in orthopedics usually the T1 weighted and a fat suppressed sequence as well, in addition as the sagittal section planes, axial and coronal section images. Currently, we use a Tesla 1.0 device. In case of findings that cannot be explained, additional typical orthopedic examination methods are used, such X-rays, ultrasound at our institute, or CT, scintigraphy, PET, SPECT, not at our institute. Next, please. Here's one example of a 23-year-old applicant who wants to become a jet pilot. The initial T1 weighted MRI images of the cervical spine show the hyperintensive signals in the sagittal image of the second thoracic vertebrae. For further analysis and differentiation of the finding of the second thoracic vertebrae, additional T1 weighted and steel sequences were performed, as well as axial and coronal sections. The diagnosis is a vertebral hemangioma. Next, please. The following example shows an abnormal finding at the intervertebral disc L5C1 of an 18-year-old asymptomatic candidate. Reduced high reduction of the signal intensity and the dorsal movement of disc tissue to the lumbar spinal canal. In this case, we conducted an additional axial section through the L5C intervertebral disc space. The diagnosis is an asymptomatic L5-C1 intervertebral disc extrusion without compression of neural structures, spinal nerves or cauda equina, no bony lumbar spinal canal stenosis and no bony neuroforaminal narrowing. Next, please. After carrying out the technical examinations in my department, orthopedic examinations are conducted by an orthopedic specialist in accordance with orthopedic standards, medical history, physical examination, evaluation of mobility, range of motion, and stability of the trunk and the extremities. Next, please. Analyzing the orthopedic aeromedical examination results of recent years, I could see that 12% of all applicants do not fulfill the requirements to being a military pilot, which are documented in German Joint Service Regulations. The main findings are displayed in the following table. I reported about it in Anchorage, Alaska, in ASMA meeting in May 2011. Next, please. Let me return to the RTO technical report 4, published in 1999. Physical conditioning programs that are known to increase G level and G duration tolerance should continue to be encouraged and supported by the operational communities of all nations. The training program should include a well-designed neck muscle stretching regime. In support of the recommendations, more research should be conducted on physical training methods for necks of fighter pilots. Next, please. Since 2010, we use 6 special devices, 2 cervical spine, 4 trunk, to determine the muscular performance of the trunk and neck muscles of applicants, candidates for Bundeswehr flying duties. The measurements are carried out by a sports scientist and the results are included in the orthopedic evaluation. Before presenting the first results of our measurements, I would like to make a few remarks on physical performance in general. Next, please. There is no doubt that pilots and crew members are exposed to high physical loads, which results in acute injuries as well as acute and chronic musculoskeletal complaints, which again restrict or even rule out the operational capability and performance. From sports medicine, we know the model of the performance structure. If we have a closer look at the physical or sporting performance, we will see that they're mainly determined by the motoric capabilities, as can be seen on the bottom line. When the framework of the aeromedical examination, we evaluate the capability strength with the help of these varied capabilities. The strength is characterized as maximum strength, strength endurance, and rate of strength and development. Next, please. If we further systemize those motoric capabilities and subdivide them into conditional energetic abilities or coordinative informational abilities, please note the interrelation among strength, speed, and mobility. Next, please. How is strength defined from a biological and physiological point of view? Strength is the ability of the nerve and the muscle system to overcome an external resistance, concentric muscle action, to act against it or give in a decelerating movement, eccentric muscle action, or to hold it, isometric muscle action, through muscle activity. Strength is the acting cause for any movement. Next, please. This dimension of strength are defined through a way and character of functioning as well as a contraction form. This is explains the following table. We distinguish between 2 main forms, static isometric strength and dynamic strength. Next, please. What is the use of regular and systematic strength training? I have a little anecdote for you regarding this topic. In an Italian retirement home, strength training devices were put up and the senior citizens started to train regularly. That means 2 or 3 times a week, being supervised by an expert. What was the result? After 3 months, 15% of the retirement home's residents had moved out again. Strength training has important and manifold function in the field of sports, health, preventive and rehabilitation medicine. Next, please. The following effects of strength training has been evaluated. Improvement of strength and resilience of tendons, ligaments, joints, cartilage and bones. Prevention of falling posture among adolescents. Prevention of degenerative spinal change and back pain due to stresses of work and everyday life. Strength training is used for primary, secondary and tertiary prevention. Strength training is used for rehabilitation after injury or disease. Strength training is used for therapy of chronic back pain. And in sports medicine and sports science, strength training is a legal means to maintain and increase physical fitness as well as to increase resilience and the ability to withstand stress. Next, please. But let us get back what we do and what will still we do. The two keywords are diagnostic and prevention training, as known as the following principle from medicine. No diagnostics, no therapy. First priority regarding our activities to determining the muscular performance of trunk and neck muscles of the applicants and candidates and active pilots. In our consolidating approach using the orthopedic and anthropometric examination results, performance shall be determined, deficits shall be identified, and training programs shall be developed. And all of this in every evaluation phase at our institute. For the purpose, we need the sports scientist as well as some expertise from the field of training science. This support we receive thanks to our cooperation with the Institute of Sport and Sport Science at the Bundeswehr University Munich. The applicants have to do prevention training themselves afterwards, just like the candidates and pilots will do it in their corresponding units. For controlling of fitness results, muscle strength, we are still lacking personnel and other capabilities. Next, please. What do we do actually? Our diagnostic consists of 6 individual devices, 2 cervical spine, 4 trunk, a central PC evaluation unit and a special software. You can see the devices right here. Please note the device FBZ-HE is a combined set for the measurement of the cervical spine flexion, extension, cervical spine lateral flexion right side and left side. Next, please. Which test methods do we use? For equipment-specific and time reasons, we use 2 test methods. First, we determine the maximum strength using the so-called 5-second muscle test, and afterwards, we determine the isometric strength endurance, 100 second, 50% of the maximum strength. These tests are conducted of all 6 planes and movement of the cervical spine and the trunk, which means 24 measurements have to be done. Afterwards, we calculate the strength ratio, flexion action, right left, 12 strength rations, so that we can enter 36 measuring values into a database and assess them at the end of 1 measuring program. Both tables show our data sheets. Next, please. Which results can I present to you? From January 2011 until September 2011, 9 months, 428 young men were measured using 6 different strength measuring devices made by Schnell Enterprises. The following table shows the results of the strength measurements. Group A consists for applicants, that means school leavers who want to become Bundeswehr pilots, average age of 20 years, and Group B consists of candidates, that means young soldiers, officers who are about to start their basic pilot training, average age of 23 years. This table describes our results taking trunk flexion and action as an example and using maximum strength as the only parameter. Hereby, the absolute maximum strength is indicated in Newton meters and the relative maximum strength in Newton meters per kilogram body weight. What does the measurement results tell us? applicants and candidates do not differ regarding the relative and absolute maximum strain of the trunk flexion extension, which is also true for all muscle groups of the cervical spine and the trunk. This assumes that our primary prevention concerning for a better muscle performance is not very successful. Next, please. But this is not the goal of the study. We want to define minimum requirements for applicants, candidates, and active pilots regarding the muscular performance. To this end, take a look at the following two tables. Taking the 222 applicants as an example, as a reminder, young male, civilians, school leavers, we calculated the first and second standard deviation of muscular performance, and that again by using the example of the absolute and relative trunk flexion and action. In the second lower table, 7, we examined how many applicants would fulfill the calculated standard values. Taking the bottom standard values minus one standard deviation, at least 81% meets the calculated standard value. Taking a standard value minus two standard deviation, a minimum of 96% meets the calculated standard value. For statistical reasons, we want to measure and evaluate 600 young men. That equals roughly our number of applicants per year. As a conclusion, we will then define the minimum requirements. Next, please. Which strength training methods do we have? We distinguish strength training methods according to the muscle function, training effects, and strength manifestations. Strength training methods according to the muscle functions are static or isometric strength training, positive dynamic, negative dynamic, positive negative dynamic hybrid forms. Next, please. Strength training methods according to training effects are training methods to increase the muscle mass, training methods to develop the intramuscular coordination, training methods to develop the reactive strength, pliometric training, and training methods to develop the strength endurance. Next, please. Strength training methods according to strength manifestation are maximum, springiness, and strength duration training. These three main methods you can divide in 9 subgroups. I do not walk to these groups because time reasons. Next, please. Which training is most suitable for pilots? Basically, it would be now time to make a statement on which muscle training would be useful for a pilot from our point of view. Because training devices and trained personnel, sports scientists, trainer, are not available at any time in any place. We started a study on this topic, which unfortunately we couldn't not finish yet. We formed 4 groups for 30 subjects each. The subjects were all healthy young men with no back pain, aged between 20 and 27 years, and officer cadets of the German Air Force School in Fürsti. The anthropometric data, the bioimpedance data, and the muscle strength relative and absolute maximum strain were measured before and after training. The subjects of Group A did device-based strength training twice a week for at least 45 minutes over a period of 3 months. The subjects of Group B did the strength cycle training twice a week for 45 minutes, 16 exercises from Wendt Uwe Böck-Behrens. They did it on their own without guidance and without devices, the so-called MaxFit program. The subjects of Group C did twice a week a functional gymnastics with proprioceptive training, and that under supervision. Control group D worked out at least twice a week for 45 minutes individually and without guidance. We will finish the study in summer 2012. Next, please. Summary. Pilots need skills and capabilities to accomplish his or her military mission. Orthopedics within aviation medicine can attribute significantly to the evaluation and development of physical performance. Preconditions in this case are not only orthopedic expertise, but also capabilities and skills in the area of sports medicine and sports science. Those need to be available and sit together with qualified personnel and diagnostic devices. No diagnostics, no training. Next, please. The basis of any training program in the exact determination of the individual fitness, no matter it is for individual, general, aviation-specific or high-performance training purposes. Realistic training goals must be formulated. The high cost of personnel and material can be reduced by using facilities and personnel on site. It does not necessarily have to be a device-based training under supervision, which would be the best solution. Medical findings from top-class sports be applied to optimize the operational fitness of military personnel or pilots. The fact that my department is the participant and partner of a national multi-center study called MySpec Network until 2014, which is sponsored by the Federal Ministry of Interior, shows that the path we have chosen is the right one. Next, please. This finished my presentation. Thank you very much.
Are there any questions? No. Okay, and again, I have a question. So maybe you can pop it up, get out your clickers, and get ready to vote. I think you already started. Let's see, we had 88 people voting before. More people. Let's see what we get. Ooh, something changed there. Wow. You're going for the Dilemma Award.